Hi everyone, this is Zuleika from Erureka. With enormous amount of data generating each minute, the need to extract the useful insights is a must for a business in today's world. This is where data science comes in, and in this session on what is data science, we're going to go in depth about the various concepts of data science and why it's needed in today's world. So let's move ahead and take a look at today's agenda. So we're going to begin with the importance of data science and why it is needed. Next, we'll see what exactly data science is. After that, we'll understand data science with a simple analogy. And then we'll move on to a funny use case of data science. Once we're done with that, I'll take you through each stage of data science, explaining how the data science lifecycle works. Now, there's always a confusion about where data science fits in with machine learning and artificial intelligence, and I'll clear that confusion for you. And then we'll discuss about how Netflix used data science to become a billion-dollar website. Next, we'll take a look at market basket analysis, which basically shows how local retail shops gain useful insights about customers' buying habits. Then we'll discuss the association rule mining algorithm and the a priori algorithm that we'll be implementing in our demo. After that, we'll finally move on to the demo, where I'll be showing you how to increase the sales of a retail shop by analyzing the customer's shopping behavior. We'll be performing this demo with a huge transactional data set, and we'll be using a priori and association rule mining algorithm to make predictions about how customers shop and how to improve the sales. Finally, I'll wind up the session with some facts about data science and why you should be learning data science. All right, so let's move ahead and take a look at our first topic. So do you guys remember when most of the data was stored in Excel sheets? There were simpler times because we generated lesser data and the data was quite structured. Back then, simple business intelligent tools were used to analyze and process the data. But times have changed. Over 2.5 quintillion bytes of data are created every single day. And it's only going to grow from there. By 2020, it's estimated that 1.7 MB of data will be created every second for every person on Earth. Now, can you imagine how much data that is? How are we going to process this much data? Not only that, the data generated these days is mostly unstructured or semi-structured, and simple business intelligent tools cannot do the work anymore. We need more complex and effective algorithms to process and extract useful insights from the data. Now, this is where data science comes into the picture. It analyzes and extracts useful insights from data. So let's look at what is data science. Now, the term data science may scare you off, but understanding it is quite simple. Let's break it down. So we have data and science. Now, what is data? Now, data can be any raw information or structured data collected from n number of sources, like for example, the transactional data from an e-commerce website, or survey data, or even numbers and images form data. On the other hand, what is science? Now, science is the process of exploring, observing, and making sense out of something. This takes us to what is data science. Then data science is the process of extracting knowledge and insights from data by using scientific methods. Okay, now that was sort of a bookish definition. So let's try to understand data science with a simple example. What if I tell you guys that all humans in some way are already data scientists? You're observing the world around you no matter what you're doing. At every waking moment, you're taking in details from your surroundings and feeding it to your brain. You then process these observations into data and use it to understand things around you by finding out meanings and make predictions of what is likely to happen next. So let's say that you're driving your car to office and there are two ways to go to your office. One is a shortcut, let's call it route A, and the other route is relatively longer, let's label it route B. Now obviously you and I would choose route A to get to work, but let's say that from a distance you notice that there is way too much traffic on route A. And from your past experiences of getting stuck in traffic, you know that if you take the shortcut, you'll be very late to office. So what do? So you do the calculations and you decide to take route B, which is a longer route but with no traffic. Now, how is this related to data science? Now, we were obviously facing a problem, and let's break it down into steps. First, let's define the problem. So the problem that we're facing is we want to choose the fastest route to office. Okay, we want to get to work quick. Now, the next step would be to collect data. Now, how did we collect data? We observed our surroundings and we noticed that there was a lot of traffic on route A when compared to route B. That's how we collected data, and that's exactly how you're collecting data right now. You're listening to me and taking in information. So after observing the surroundings, if we were to put this data into a table, it would look something like this. So we observe route A and we calculate the distance to office from route A, and we also calculate a speed. Alright, we also consider the day of week it is, the time of day, humidity and traffic flow. Let's say that we just observed the surrounding and collected this data. So this is the second step of data science, data collection. Alright, now let's look at data processing. Now when we collected data about the traffic on route A, we also collected a lot of unnecessary data. Like the color of the cars, the different type of two-wheelers. We also collected data like the humidity of the air. Now this data is obviously not required to determine the fastest route to office. So what do? We ignore this data. Now this process of removing unwanted data or irrelevant data is called data cleaning. So in the next table here, you can see that I've removed the humidity column because that is not required to analyze which route will take us to office quicker. Also, while you collect data, there are a lot of things that you need to fix and adjust. I mentioned the distance over here in 14,000 meters, but to adjust it according to our other measurements, I'm converting it into kilometers. Now, this process is basically data cleaning and data processing. So you're just preparing the data so that you can analyze the data and come up with good predictions as to which is the faster route. Okay, this is all a part of data science. Now, next is exploring and analyzing the data. Now, after collecting the data about the traffic situation on route A, we decided to look at route B. We observed that route B had lesser traffic and calculated the approximate time it would take to get to office by using route B. Now, based on our past experience of getting stuck in traffic jams, we predicted that taking route A to office is more time consuming, and hence we decided to take route B. So we basically extracted the useful information from the data we collected by understanding and analyzing the data in order to predict the faster route to office. And this is exactly what data science is. It is the ability to take data, to be able to understand it, to process it, and to extract value from it. Now, the exploring and analyzing data includes the selection of the decision variables. Now, the decision variables are time and traffic delay with respect to our example. Here you can see that if we take route A, it'll take us 1 hour 20 minutes. But if we take route B, it'll take us 2 hours. But due to traffic on route A, there's going to be a delay of 55 minutes. So obviously, when you do the calculations, you know that route A will take you 2 hours 15 minutes and route B will take you 2 hours. So now we choose the best and the fastest route to office, which is route B. Now, this was a small analogy of the different steps in data science. So first, we defined the problem, which was to choose the fastest route. After that, we collected data. And how did we do that? We just observed the surroundings and we collected the information. After that, we processed the data, wherein we performed data cleaning and removed the unwanted or the irrelevant data. After that, we performed exploring and analyzing, wherein we identified the decision variables and predicted their values. Then finally comes to our solution, where we chose the best route to office. I hope all of you understood this analogy. Now, before we jump into the data science process, let's understand what this process is all about. Now, the power of data is already shaping our lives in ways that we probably don't realize. The fact that we spend our time on the internet, like shopping, paying bills, online dating, socializing, and whatnot, we don't realize that all the data that we provide during such activities is stored and processed. So every time you shop, retailers are actually analyzing your buying patterns and trying to figure out your likes and dislikes, as well as what other products you might buy or coupons you would use. Now, to make you understand the influence of data science, let me tell you a funny incident. By the way, guys, this is a true story. This incident is about a Target statistician called Andrew Pohl. For those of you who don't know what Target is, it is a retail store. Now, Andrew was analyzing the data of his customers and he was looking for patterns to determine if a shopper was expecting a baby. Now, he ran tests after tests and finally some useful patterns emerged. Lotions, for example. A lot of people buy lotions, but one of Pohl's colleagues noticed that women on the baby register were buying larger quantities of unscented lotion, okay? And this was around the beginning of their second trimester. Another analyst noted that sometime in the first 20 weeks, pregnant women loaded up on the supplements like calcium, magnesium, and zinc. Many shoppers purchased soap and cotton balls, but when somebody suddenly starts buying lots of scent-free soaps extra big bags of cotton balls, in addition to hand sanitizers and washcloths, it's a signal that they could be getting close to that delivery date. Now, based upon their so-called pregnancy scores, Target started sending coupons. Now, one angry father contacted Target about all the baby coupons they were sending his teenage daughter. He was accusing them of encouraging her daughter to get pregnant. The funny part was that Target had actually figured out the teenage daughter was pregnant before the father knew it. Now, that was a true story. So people look out for guys like Andrew. They probably know more about you than your parents do. All right, now that you know how powerful data can be if you analyze it properly with effective algorithms and tools, let's look at the data science process, which is all about getting such useful insight from data. So despite the recent increase in computing power and access to data over the last couple of years, our ability to use the data within the decision-making process is lost. Now, when an organization is facing an issue or a problem, they should be able to apply the data correctly to solve the problem. Okay, that's how data science works. Now, let's understand the data science lifecycle. There are 6 steps in the cycle. It starts with defining the business requirements, then acquiring data, processing it, exploring it, creating a model, and then deploying it. All right, now let's look at each of these in a detailed manner. So before you can even start on a data science project, it is critical that you understand the problem you are trying to solve. In this stage, you should also be identifying the central objectives of your project by identifying the variables that need to be predicted. Now, in the analogy I showed you earlier, our problem was to choose the fastest route, and the variables that we had to predict were time and traffic delay. Next is the data acquisition process. Now that you've defined the objectives of your project, it's time to start gathering the data. Data mining is a process of gathering your data from different sources. Now, at this stage, some of the questions worth considering are, what data do I need for my project? Where does it live? How can I obtain it? What is the most efficient way to store and access all of it? Let's answer all of these questions based on the analogy. What data do I need for my project? So when we were trying to choose the fastest route, the data we needed included the traffic density, the distance, the speed, the time. All right, where does the data live? So the data that we collected was from our surrounding. Next is, how can I obtain it? We obtained by observing and understanding our surrounding. After that, what is the most efficient way to store and access all of it? Now, the most effective way we stored it and accessed and analyzed it was by building a table out of the data that we collected. All right. Next stage is data processing. Now, if all the data necessary for the project is packed and handed to you, then you've literally won a lottery. Now, usually finding the right data takes both time and effort. If the data lives in a database, your job is very simple. You just have to query the relevant data using SQL queries. But if your data doesn't actually exist in a data set, you'll have to scrape it. Now, this is where you transform your data into the desired format so that you can read the data. All right, now let's say you've got all of your data and now you have it in the right format. Now, the next step is the most time-consuming step of all. It's called cleaning and preparing the data, or data cleaning. Now, this is especially true in big data projects. A lot of data scientists were sat down and their interviews were taken, and they were asked which is the most hectic or the most hated phase of data science. And up to 80% of them said it was data cleaning because it takes up 50 to 80% of their time. Now, the reason why data cleaning takes so long is because there are so many possible scenarios that require cleaning. So, for example, the data could have multiple inconsistencies. Your data could have missing values, or there might be some unnecessary data which has to be removed. So these inconsistencies have to be identified and fixed in this stage. Okay, now that you have a sparkling clean set of data, you're ready to finally get started on your analysis. Now, the data exploration stage is like the brainstorming of data analysis. So this is where you understand all the patterns in your data. Okay, it could involve pulling up and analyzing a random set of data by plotting a histogram, or you can even create an interactive visualization that lets you explore each data point and the story behind the data. So this is where you retrieve all of your useful insights from the data. Now, with all the useful information, you start to form hypotheses, or you start to make predictions about your data. Now, in our analogy, based on our past experiences, we predicted that due to traffic on Route A, it might take us longer to reach to office through Route A. And that's when we decided to consider route B. All right. So this is where you explore, make predictions, and form hypotheses about your data. All right. Now the next stage is data modeling. Now there are three main tasks in this stage. The first is to create data features from the data that you processed. Now the second is model training. Now model training is basically about finding the model that answers the questions most accurately. Okay. Now the process for model training involves a lot of steps and iterations. So the first step would be to split the input data into training data set and test data set. You split it randomly. Next is you build the model by using the training data set. After that, you'll evaluate the training and the test data set, and you'll use a series of machine learning algorithms. And then you'll determine the best solution, and you'll determine if your model is suitable for production. Okay. And finally, the last stage is deployment. The goal of this stage is to deploy the data models into a production or a production-like environment. Okay. And this is for the final user acceptance. Also, the users must validate the performance of the models, and if there are any issues with the model, then they must be fixed in this stage. The maintenance and operations of the data models take place in this phase. So guys, this was all about the data science lifecycle. Now, next up, let me clear your confusion about the relationship between artificial intelligence, machine learning, data science, and deep learning. Now, there's a lot of misconception about machine learning and artificial intelligence. People tend to think that AI, machine learning, and deep learning are all the same thing. Well, they're not, and let's define each of these concepts so you know where to draw a line. Now, in the image, you can see that data science is a larger and a vaster concept which makes use of all of these different techniques, artificial intelligence, machine learning, and deep learning. Now, like I mentioned earlier, data science is the extraction of knowledge from data by using different techniques and algorithms. On the other hand, artificial intelligence is a technique which enables machines to mimic human behavior. AI is very different when you compare it to data science. Now, machine learning is a subset of AI which uses statistical methods to enable machines to improve with experience. We use a lot of machine learning algorithms when it comes to data science. Now, again, deep learning is a subset of machine learning. It includes concepts like neural networks in order to go in depth and look for solutions. Okay, so guys, this was the difference between data science, AI, machine learning, deep learning. So I hope I've cleared your confusion between all of them. Artificial intelligence, machine learning, deep learning are all techniques and methods that can be used in data science. And there is a lot more to each of these than I have defined over here. AI, machine learning, deep learning, all of these are not restricted to data science alone. They can be used in any field right now. All right, now let's look at the Netflix use case. So guys, with over 100 million subscribers, there is no doubt that Netflix is the father of the online streaming world. Netflix's speedy rise has all movie industrialists taken aback. Okay, they keep asking how on earth could one single website take on Hollywood? Now, the answer to this is data. The Netflix algorithm constantly gathers massive amounts of data about users' activities. Now, they keep a track of activities like when you pause a video, when you rewind, or when you fast forward. They also keep a track of what day you watch your content on, the date you watch it, what time you watch it, where you're watching it, the different devices that you use to watch it. They have data about your ratings, your searches, your browsing, and scrolling behavior. All right, so they have data about each and every activity you do on the website. And they collect a lot more data. Now, they collect this data for each subscriber they have, and that's why they have such a huge customer retention rate. All right, so they have the behavioral patterns of each and every customer. By collecting so much information about a person, you can obviously try and figure out what are their likes, what are their dislikes, what videos they might be interested in, what movies they might watch, what they might not watch, and all of that. Okay, now what do they do with all of this data? They've collected it, but what do they do with it? Now, on the right-hand side is a list of things that they do with the data that they collect, okay? So, they find the next smash hit series. Now, it was recently surveyed that Netflix spent $100 million on 26 episodes of a show called House of Cards, okay? They were very confident that the show would be marketed successfully to their audience, okay? This is obviously because they had a behavioral pattern of their audience. They know what the audience liked. They know what the majority of the audience would watch. What would draw their interest, all right? Now, the next thing they do is they create personalized video rankers. Now, what this ranker does is it orders the entire Netflix collection for for each subscriber in a personalized way. Right? So each subscriber of Netflix has a different Netflix collection based on the user's likes, dislikes, interests. Okay? They also have a top N video ranker, which picks out the top personalized recommendations from the entire catalog, focusing only on the titles that are at the top of the ranking. So again, they keep analyzing your data. They pick out top 10 videos just for you. Okay, so each member or each subscriber on Netflix has a totally different view of the Netflix website. So if you're into rom-coms, you'll have all about rom-coms on your Netflix account. I'm sure I don't have to speak much about this. Almost all of us use Netflix and know how it works. We always get what we want to watch, all right? Apart from that, they also create a section called Trending Now. They create the most trending videos along with a mix of personalization for every member based on their viewing history. Then they have this other session called Continue Watching. Now, this just sorts your recently viewed titles and it will estimate whether you will continue watching or if you'll stop watching something because it was less interesting, okay? And also they have a video-video similarity algorithm. Now, because you watch one video, you may also like a similar video. Even though the similarity ranking is not very personalized, it provides a very good estimate of what a member might like based on what they previously watched. Okay? There is a lot of data processing and a lot of data science involved behind Netflix. They have hundreds of algorithms which tells them what users would like to watch and what they'd quickly lose their interest in. Okay, now this is exactly why Netflix is such a huge thing. They collect data and they use it in the most effective way possible. All right, now let's look at market basket analysis. Now, this might be a relatively new term for most of you. Now, market basket analysis is a key technique used by large retailers to uncover associations between items. So it basically allows retailers to identify relationships between the items that people buy. For example, people who buy bread also tend to buy jam. So the marketing teams at the retail store should target customers who buy bread and jam and provide them an offer so that they can buy a third item like an egg. So if a customer buys bread and butter and sees a discount or an offer on eggs, he will be encouraged to spend more and buy the eggs. This is what market basket analysis is all about. Now guys, to find the association between two items and make predictions about what customers will buy, there are two algorithms. The first one is called the association rule mining and the second one is the a priori algorithm. Okay, now let's discuss each of these algorithms with an example. So let's say that you're given a market basket data and you have to analyze those items together in a basket and see if there is any interesting relationship in the buying behavior of the customers. But take a note that you cannot assume that there is an association between two products just because they were brought together 2-3 times. You have to analyze hundreds of transactions to find a pattern or an association between two items. So for example, here it says that people who buy bread have a 60% chance of also buying jam. Now this can be because a lot of people prefer bread and jam for breakfast. And similarly, people who purchase laptops will buy laptop bags because that makes sense. But what are we going to do with these insights? And how are these insights going to help our business? Alright, so let's assume that you have a huge retail store and let's call it DMart. Okay, so you're the owner of the store. And let's say that you gave me the transaction data of your store and you asked me to look for some important insights. Now, after going through the transaction data, I found some insights which say that 80% of the customers who are buying bread would also end up buying butter. So I got this insight from your transaction data. Now, what would you do with this insight? Is it useful to you? Well, the insight I gave you is very strong. Now, 80% of the customers who buy bread also buy butter, which means that 80% of the people who buy bread will anyway buy butter. And so there is no point in giving offers on these two products. And you can be smarter and place bread and butter at the opposite ends of your store. Now, this way the customer will have to cover a large floor area to get to the butter, which means that the customer will get a chance to look at all the products in your store and he will definitely put many other products into his cart. Okay, this is what is called impulsive buying and I'm a huge victim of this, which I do all the time. Okay, now I'm sure this has happened to all of us. So when we go to the grocery store or any store to buy a list of items, we actually end up buying a lot of other things that we didn't plan on buying. Now, even though I didn't intend to buy all of these products, I did because you were smart enough to arrange these products logically in your store. Okay, so guys, this was a simple insight, but if you go to a professional data scientist with all your transactional data, imagine what all insights you'll get and how much it'll profit your store. So because of this, association rule mining is considered as a very useful model for finding the product's association and placement of the products and thus improving the sales. Okay, now I hope all of you understood the significance of this algorithm. Now let's move ahead and look at how the algorithm works. Now, association rule mining is all about building rules. So we can form rules like if a person buys item A, then he'll end up buying item B. Okay. Now, when we analyze a large set of transactional data, we'll probably come up with thousands of such rules. And the rules we just discussed is a single cardinality rule, meaning that the result of buying one item will end up buying another one. Okay. So people who bought A would also buy B. But what if I say people who bought A and B also bought C, or people who buy A, B and C item will also buy D? So this rule with increasing cardinality can have many combinations. So let's say that you have 10,000 products in your store. Imagine the number of possible combinations you can have for each product. So going through each of this product and analyzing its association with the other 9,999 products is practically not possible. That's why in association rule mining, we have certain measures that filter the items at each iterations. Okay, this is where the other algorithm called a priori comes into the picture. But before we go into the algorithm part, let's understand the basic math behind the algorithm. Now, there are three basic metrics which we'll discuss now. There is support, confidence, and lift. All right, the first metric, support, calculates the number of times an item A or a set of items A and B occur in the overall transactions. Okay, so by calculating support, we'll know which items are bought most frequently or which combination of items are bought most frequently. Also, by calculating support, we can filter out the items that occur less frequently. Now, the next one is confidence. Confidence calculates the number of times items A and B occur together given the number of times A occurs. Okay, now this measure calculates how often two items occur together. Now, typically before you build the a priori algorithm, you set the minimum value for support and for confidence. But how do we choose the support value and the confidence value? Now, honestly, there's no fixed way in which you can choose the support and the confidence values, but you can choose these two measures very intuitively. So if I say that the minimum support value is 2, all right, let's assume that I've set my minimum support value to 2. Now, this means that if a product occurs in at least 2% of the transactions, only then you can analyze the buying patterns of the product. Okay. Now, this makes sense because obviously we wouldn't want to analyze products which are barely bought. Now, depending on your sales and products, you can set the minimum support and confidence values. Now, after you've set the minimum confidence and support values, you have to input these values in your algorithm so that it can filter out only the useful or the most frequently bought products. Now, there is another measure called lift. Okay. Now, let's say that you ran the algorithm and you finally came out with 5,000 or 10,000 association rules, which are basically insights. Okay. It is practically impossible to implement all of these rules. Imagine going through all of these rules for each product and then implementing them. This is obviously not practical. Okay. So it's very important to filter out the most significant and only the most effective rules. Now, this is exactly why we have the lift metrics. Now, lift indicates the strength of a rule. Now, take a look at the denominator of this formula. It calculates the independent support of item A and of item B. Okay. Now, this basically shows the probability of A and B occurring independent of each other. Now, obviously, there's a lot of difference between A and B randomly occurring together and A and B actually having some association. Now, if the denominator of the lift is higher than your numerator, then it means that A and B are randomly co-occurring with each other and not because of any association between them. Okay. So if the value of lift is high for any set of products, you can improve that rule. Okay, lift will help you filter out only the significant insights or the significant rules. So let's say that the lift of two items A and B is 4. It means that if I buy item A, then I'm 4 times more likely to buy item B. Okay, so guys, these were the three measures. Now, to make you understand the math, let's look at some example. So the problem statement is to come out with the best rules by using the three measures, which is support, confidence, and lift. Now, before we look at this example, let's go understand what a priori algorithm does. Now, the purpose of a priori is to calculate which item set is a frequent item set. All right. Now, let's say that my store has 5,000 items. What this a priori algorithm does is it filters down a set of, let's say, 10 items, which are the most frequently purchased items. So if my algorithm can filter down 5,000 items to just 10 items, then I can form different combinations with these 10 items and create rules for each combination. Okay. Now, I know that's confusing. So let's look at an example to better understand this. So let's just take this example and let's say that my algorithm selected 5 products, A, B, C, D, and E. Now, it said that these 5 products are the most frequently purchased products. Okay. Now, what I can do is I can form various rules and associations. Like, for example, these are the rules that I form. Okay. I have A, B, C, D, and E. Now, I can form some rules like this. Now, the first rule is basically that if I buy item A, then there is a probability that I will buy item D. Okay, similarly, I can form a lot of such rules by trying out different combinations of A, B, C, D, E. Okay, but how do we get to the most frequent item set? Now, these 5 products that I just spoke about, how do you narrow down from 5,000 to 5 most frequent products? Now, this is where a priori will come in. Okay, it will generate the frequent item set, after which you can form different combinations to generate association rules. Also note that frequent item set is a set of items which are created at the end. So after filtering down all of the items, the last set that you come up with is your frequent item set. Now these are obviously the most frequently occurring or the most frequently purchased items. Also, each item in the frequent item set must have a support of at least the minimum support value that we fix. Now let's see how all of this is done. Now I know there was a lot of theory, so let's practically look at how this is done. Okay, we'll look at the math behind this and then we'll move on to a demo where we'll be processing a huge transactional data set and we'll try to extract useful insights from there. Okay, all right, now consider these simple set of transactions. So TID basically denotes the transaction ID and items from 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 denote the different items. Okay. And like I said, we have to fix the minimum support value before building the algorithm. So here I've set the minimum support value as 2. This simply means that out of the 5 transactions, at least in 2 transactions, you should get the item to pass that minimum support criteria. All right. Now let's look at the first iteration. Okay. Now your first step would be to make an item set of size 1 and calculate the support for each item set. So for example, in the C1 table over here, you can see that the item set 1 has a support value of 3. Now, how did I get this value 3? Now, this is because in these transactions, you can see that 1 occurs 3 times. 1 is in T1, in T3, and T5. Okay, it occurs here, here, and over here. That's why the support value is 3. All right. Now, similarly for item set 2 also, it occurs 3 times. It occurs in T2, it occurs in T3, and it occurs in T4. But if you look at item number 4, it occurs only once in the transaction number T1. Now, since the support value of the item 4 is 1, now this is less than the minimum support value we set. This item 4 gets filtered out or gets eliminated. Now, because this item set has a support value of 1, which is less than our minimum support value, we'll have to eliminate this item. So once you eliminate, the table F1 represents the new item sets. So we have 1, 2, 3, and 5. So item number 4 got eliminated because its support value was less than the minimum support value. All right. Now the rest of the items move on to the next iteration. So this basically helps us narrow down the frequent items that occur in the transaction. Okay. Now next what we do is with these 4 items, we form item sets with higher cardinality. Now over here, we had an item set with only 1 item in it. Now we'll increase the cardinality to 2 and have 2 items in an item set. Now to get 2 items, you simply just create all possible combinations with these 4 items. So with 1, 2, 3, 5, you create all possible combinations. So here you can see we have 1, 2, 1, 3, 1, 5, 2 and 3, 2 and 5, 3 and 5. These are all the possible combinations. Now we started off with a one cardinality item set. We filtered out the less frequent items and then we formed the two cardinality item set. And we're similarly going to filter them as well. Okay. Now after you calculate the support for these two cardinality item sets, you can see that 1, 2, which is the first item set over here, it has a support of 1, which means that item 1 and 2 occur together only one time, and that is in transaction 3. Okay, in T3 here, you can see that 1 and 2 occur together. All right, now this is the only time where you can see 1 and 2 together. So this item set can be eliminated. Okay, because the support value of this item set is only 1, whereas our minimum support value has to be 2. So once you eliminate this item set, you get the new item set, which is in table F2. All right. So now what you do is you repeat the same process. In the next iteration, we've created item sets with cardinality as 3. So if you look at table C3, you see that there are item sets consisting of 3 items. Now in the third iteration, after getting 3 cardinality item sets, we need to check if the subsets of each of these item sets have already been eliminated, or we need to check if any of these subsets have a support less than the minimum support value. So let's do that. Now, all right, so these were my 3 cardinality item sets. Now I just divided each of these sets into subsets. Okay, so 1, 2, 3 has 1, 2, it has 1, 3 and 2, 3. So when we do that, we can see that item set 1, 2, 3 and item set 1, 2, 5, which are the first two item sets, have a subset of 1, 2. And if you remember that we eliminated this item set in the second iteration because its support value was less than 2. Now go back to the second iteration. Here you can see that 1, 2 was eliminated because its support value was 1. But here we can see that this 1, 2 is a subset of these two item sets. So now we can eliminate item set 1, 3 and 1, 5. Because their subsets don't clear the minimum support criteria. Now, after eliminating 1, 2, 3 and 1, 2, 5, we are left with 1, 3, 5 and 2, 3, 5. Now, both these item sets have a support value of 2. Okay. Now, this is good, but when we increase the cardinality to 4, their support drops to less than the minimum support value. So, it basically drops to 1. Okay. Now, at this point, we know that we shouldn't further increase the cardinality. Then we won't even get any frequent item set. Okay, so the whole point of this iteration or the whole point of this filtering process is so that we get the most frequent items. Now, what we can do is we can go back and select the 3 cardinality item sets. So we've selected these 2 item sets and we can create rules for them. Now, these 2 item sets are the frequent item sets calculated by our algorithm. Now, for 1, 3, 5, 1, 3, 1, 5, 3, 5, 1, 3, 5, are the subsets. Okay. Similarly, for item set 2, 3, 5, also we have subsets. Now, I can create rules by forming combinations within each of these item sets. So far, it was a very simple process. You begin with creating a single cardinality item set. You calculate the support for each of the item sets, and then you eliminate any item set that does not meet the minimum support criteria. Now, after that, you increase the cardinality, and you do the same thing until you get the frequent item sets. Alright, so now we can go and create the rules, and remember that we haven't used confidence and lift measure till this point. Now here I'm going to assume that our confidence value is 60%. Okay, so I'm setting my minimum confidence value as 60%. Now here rule number 1, say that if people buy item 1 and 3, they will also buy item 5. Okay, now that has a confidence of 60%. Similarly, item 1 and 5 go good with item 3. Alright, this has a confidence of 100%. Which is greater than my minimum confidence value. All right. Now we have some more rules over here and we've rejected rule number 5 and rule number 6. Okay. We've done this because they do not meet the minimum confidence criteria. So rule number 5 says that if item 3 is bought, then 1 and 5 are also bought. This might seem similar to the rule number 1 that we saw, but the order here is different. And remember that the order matters when you're making rules. Now the last step is to understand the rules with the highest lift. Okay, to do this, we'll understand that in our demo. Now, basically, in this demo, we have a huge transactional data set. Guys, one more thing I want to tell you all is that I'm going to use the R language. If you are not familiar with R, then it's okay because it's very understandable. When I'm doing the demo, you can clearly understand. But if you still have doubts and you want to learn R, I'm going to leave a link in the description. Okay, you can check out the video, and then if you're more comfortable, you can come back and perform the demo. Okay, but for those of you who are beginners, I suggest you watch the video first because it's very understandable. I'm going to explain each and every step over here. Now, whatever we just discussed about market basket analysis, we're going to practically perform that in this demo. We're going to use a real data set which has thousands and thousands of transactions. We're going to filter out the most frequent items, and we're going to plot all of this data. Now, before we move on to our R code, let me just show you our transaction data. All right, so guys, this is the transaction data in CSV format. Now, because I've opened it with an Excel sheet, you can't actually see the comma separated style. So look at these rows, rows number 1, 2, 3, 4, all of these. These rows denote the transactions, okay? And the columns will just denote the different items, right? So here I have citrus fruit. You can see it's written over here, citrus fruit. Then there is semi-finished bread. Similarly, I have different items in different columns. All right. So guys, this is our data set. Now let me open up the program. So guys, I'm using RStudio to run my code. I'm going to explain each and every line of code. So don't get intimidated if you don't understand R. It's very, very understandable. All right. Now the best part about R is that it comes with a set of packages that take care of all your algorithms. So here we have the ARules package, all right? So here the first line says install.packages ARules. Now this package takes care of all our algorithms that we're going to use. So we don't actually have to sit and code the algorithms, okay? That way R is very helpful because coding algorithms takes a lot of time and a lot of effort. So the first command is just installation of the package called ARules, all right? So it says install.packages and the name of the package. All right, so what you can do is let's select each line and let's run each line, okay? All right, so this package has got installed. Now let's run the second line. Now this second line will just load this package. All right, let's run it. Now this console here shows that it's loaded. Now the third line over here has a variable called datagr. Now this variable just reads the data. It reads the transaction data which is stored in this path. So I have my file groceries.csv. All right, this file is stored in this folder, which is stored in this folder and on the desktop. Now, guys, the data that I have over here in my Excel sheet, this is raw data. Now, in order for ARules to understand this data, I'm going to use this function read.transactions. Okay, so it's just going to read the data. All right, so let's just run this line. So we're going to run each line one by one. All right, now let's look at the results of this. Okay, now when I run this variable, it says that the transaction is in sparse format and it has 9,835 transactions, which are basically represented by rows, and 169 items, which are represented by columns. Okay, let's look at our data. All right, so if I scroll down, you can see that there are actually 9,835 rows. Okay, so those many transactions. And we have 169 items in our list over here. Okay, let's go back to the code. Now let's run this next line, which says summary of this variable. Okay, now this variable basically stores all our transaction. Now if I run this line, it's just going to give me a detailed summary about my data. Right, so click on run. Okay, let me just expand this view. Okay, so when I run this line summary data, it again shows me that there are 9,835 transactions with the number of items that are there in the transactions. Okay. And it also shows the most frequently occurring items, which is whole milk. It occurs 2,513 times. Then item called other vegetables occurs 1,903 times. Similarly, rolls and buns occur 1,809 times, and so on. All right. Now, this length distribution is basically that in 2,159 transactions, only one item was bought. Okay. And similarly, all of these values denote that. So let's look at this last value. It says that in one transaction, 32 items were bought. Okay. So this must be an impulsive buyer who's bought 32 items in just one transaction. All right. This is what it gives. Now, this is just statistical summary of all the data, mean, median, and all of that. It also includes extended item information. Okay. Gives all of the item details. Now let's look at our next line over here. Now if I click on this next line, inspect data, What happens here is all the transactions get inspected. Now let me just run this and you'll understand what I'm saying. So basically it's giving me all the transactions. It's giving me all the items that are there in all of the transactions. Okay, so it's going to load 9,800 and something transactions over here. Okay, and it's going to show what items are there in each transaction. Okay, so this might take a while because it's almost loading 10,000 transactions. All right, guys, so it loaded all of the transactions for me and it showed me what all is there in each transaction. So the transaction with transaction ID 9835 has chicken, it has other vegetables, it has shopping bags, tropical fruits, vinegar. So this is a detailed description of each and every transaction. Now let's say that you just want the transactional information about the first three transactions. So for that, I can run this command. Okay, so let me run this. All right. So it shows me the first three transactions. The first transaction has citrus fruit, it has margarine, it has ready soups, semi-finished bread. And similarly for the other two transactions also it shows me the items. Okay. Now another such example is, so let's say you want to know the items in specific transactions. That way you can just mention the transaction ID over here in these brackets and you can mention the range. All right. Now let me just run this. I'll show you what it does. It shows me details about the three transactions, which is 1001, 1002, and 1003. Basically, these are transaction IDs, and it shows me the items that were purchased during these transactions. All right. Now let's look at the next part, which is item frequency. Now this item frequency is important. It gives the support value for any item. Over here, I've just selected any random item. It's going to give me the support of that item. Okay. If I click on run. So this is the support for abrasive cleaner. Okay, this is the item and this is the support. Okay, now let's say you want the support for the first six items. Okay, you specify the range and you'll get the support. Click on run. Okay, so for abrasive cleaner, it shows for artificial sweetener, baby cosmetics, baby food, bags, baking powder. All right, now this is the support. Now guys, remember support calculates how often an item occurs in the transaction. All right. Now you can also plot the support value. All right. Now here I've also mentioned the support value. So in this line, I'm just asking for the items which are there in 8% of the overall transactions. Okay. So by giving support value as 0.08, I'm saying items which are there in the 8% of the transactions, plot them for me. Okay. Now 8% is a lot. Let me run this and let's see what happens. Okay. So here I have, all right. So it shows me items which are there in 8% of the transactions. All right. And here you can see that whole milk is the most frequently purchased item set. All right. Now this next line over here, which says item frequency plot, and there is this variable top n is equal to 5. Now this will basically plot the top 5 items in terms of support. Okay. Let's run this and let's see what happens. Okay. So this just showed me the 5 most frequently purchased items, or the 5 most frequently occurring items in the transactions. Okay, so whole milk again is the most frequently purchased item. Okay, so this way you can list down the top 10 or the top 20 items which are most purchased. Okay, so if I change it, let's say I change it to top 10 or let's say top 15. Okay, now let's run this and see. So it shows me the top 15 items. Okay, the 15 items with the highest support. All right, now comes the key part, which is creating the models. Okay, now the a priori is the key element over here. Now to a priori, we've just passed all our data. Okay, we have passed this variable which stores all our data. We have not actually mentioned any support value or confidence value. So what happens over here is, because you've not mentioned support or confidence value over here, by default, a support and confidence value is set. Okay, and by default, the value of support is 0.1 and the value for confidence is 0.8. All right. Now, if I run this model, let's look at the summary of the model. All right, let's see what we're getting out of it. Okay, it says set of 0 rules are generated from this model. Also, guys, I forgot to tell you the function of a priori. Now, like I mentioned earlier, this algorithm just takes the data and it builds the most frequent item set. All right, and after that, it'll generate rules. But when I run this line, which says summary of model 1, I'll get set of 0 rules generated. Now this happened because we set the confidence and the support value too high. All right. So by default, the value of support was 0.1, which means that at least 10% of the transaction must contain the item. All right, so there is no item in my data which is available in 10% of the transactions. So we got zero rules because the support or the confidence is too high. So what we can do is we can adjust the support and the confidence values. Now that's why I've created another model over here. All right, it says setting support and confidence values. In the model 2, I've set two parameters, support and confidence. Support, I've set it to 0.01, which means that this will show me a list of items that are there in at least 1% of all the transactions. Okay. And similarly, I've given a confidence value as well. All right, let's run this model and let's see the summary of the model. Okay. All right. So when I run the summary of the model, you see that 15 rules are generated. Now, this is because I reduced the value of support. All right. Now, let's try to understand what this data is telling us. Now, in this length distribution, what it's saying is there are 15 rules with 3 items in them. After that, it's just returning some statistical summary to us. And then it's returning a summary of support, confidence, and lift. All right. It gives us support, confidence, and lift. All right. Now, let's just inspect this model and we'll inspect the set of rules that were generated. So let's click on inspect model. When I run this inspect model, it generates all the 15 rules. Okay, so this is the LHS, this is the RHS. So guys, you remember how we had A associated to B, which means that if item A is brought, then probably item B is also bought. Okay, this is exactly what's done over here. So what this first transaction tells us that when curd and yogurt are bought, whole milk is also bought. The support is mentioned, confidence is mentioned, and lift is mentioned. Now, what does this lift value suggest? It basically suggests that if a person buys curd and yogurt, he's 2 times more likely to buy whole milk. That's how lift works. Similarly, if a person buys butter and other vegetables, he's 2 times more likely to buy whole milk. Similarly, for everything else, they've generated support, confidence, and lift values. Now, if I wanted to inspect just the first 3 items, I would run this line. So it shows me curd yogurt with whole milk. Similarly, butter and other vegetables with whole milk, domestic egg and other vegetables with whole milk. And these are the support, confidence, and lift values. These counts just show how many transactions have these items. Let's say I wanted to sort down only the top 5 rules. To do that, I'm going to use lift parameter. Okay, because lift basically shows the strength of the rule. So this line is going to give me the top 5 rules. Okay, let's run it. Now, these are the top 5 rules. You can see that the lift value for these is 3, 2, 2, and 2. Now, this basically means that people who buy citrus fruit and root vegetables are 3 times more likely to buy other vegetables. Now, let's look at rules for specific items. Now, if you want to create rules for particular items, then you can do that as well. So, within the parameters, I'm mentioning support, confidence. And here in appearance, I'm mentioning RHS is obviously default. And in the LHS, I'm saying show me all the rules with whole milk and yogurt and the support as 0.01 and confidence as 0.2. Okay, let's just run this and see what we get. All right, so here you can see that it shows me all the transactions with yogurt and whole milk on the left hand side. Okay, so basically, I'm trying to find out if people buy yogurt, what else are they interested in? If people buy whole milk, what else are they interested in? And yogurt, what else can they buy? So guys, this is how you find rules for specific items, for particular items. All right, you can do this for any other item in the list. Just mention the name of that item in the LHS section over here, whole milk and yogurt. Mention whichever item you want to calculate and then find out how you would want to arrange these items. So guys, this was about it. This was the whole demo. Now, an extra additional step is if you want to visualize your result, then you can install this package. Okay, I'm just going to run and show it to you. Let's load the package. It's called A Rules Wiz. So I'm going to plot this model number 3, which is basically going to show me whole milk and yogurt. All right, let's plot it. So this is just going to give me the support and the confidence and the lift values. And also 9 rules are generated. You can see those 9 rules over here. These are the 9 rules. So guys, this was the end of today's demo. I hope all of you are clear with the demo. If you have any doubts, leave them in the comment section and I'll get back to you with the answers. All right. Now let's look at some data science stats. So guys, according to Forbes, the number of data science and analytic job listings is projected to grow by nearly 364,000 listings by 2020. So there's going to be a shortage of so many data scientist jobs. So guys, this shows the data science demand. There are way too many businesses, way too many e-commerce websites which are looking for data scientists. All right. Also, the average salary for a data scientist is $120,000 as per Glassdoor. Now, that is obviously a lot, but you'll obviously need a lot of experience. You need to have knowledge and expertise in a lot of areas. Okay, you need to know a lot of algorithms. You need to know how to process data. All right, it's all about data when it comes to data science. Another interesting fact is that there's going to be a shortage of 1,90,000 skilled data scientists by 2018. So guys, it's already the end of 2018 and there are so many shortages in data scientists. So guys, there are a lot of companies out there who are specifically looking for data scientists. So buckle up if you want to join the competition. All right, there's still not a lot of competition because this is just an evolving field right now. So now would be a good time to start learning about data science. Now, the last fact is that businesses analyzing data will see about 430 billion in productivity benefits over the rivals who are not analyzing data by 2020. So look at the amount of difference data science makes. A company can easily save up $430 billion if it tries to implement data science algorithms. All right, so guys, that's a lot of difference. Data science makes all the difference that you're seeing right now. So guys, the only reason why websites like Netflix, Amazon are profiting so much is because they're properly analyzing the data that they get. Now, when any user is performing some activity on Amazon website or any e-commerce website, data scientists are collecting all of this information. They're extracting all the useful insights from this information so that they can get better profit out of it. So guys, with this, we come to the end of today's session. Now, if any of you are interested in the data science course that we offer or any other course, please leave your email IDs in the comment section along with the course that you're interested in and we'll get back to you at the earliest. All right. So guys, thank you so much for joining me in today's session. Have a great day.
I hope you have enjoyed listening to this video. Please be kind enough to like it and you can comment any of your doubts and queries and we will reply them at the earliest. Do look out for more videos in our playlist and subscribe to EduReka channel to learn more. Happy learning.